Good morning. I am very grateful to the HRRC Ambassador Ong, Professor Lucy Reed, and particularly to former HR Commissioner Jamin for elaborating so much of what I needed to say today and basically saving me about 10 minutes of my presentation. Let me begin with three anecdotes in real life. First anecdote was when I served as a legal expert for the ASEAN Coordinating Committee on Investment, which held their meetings in Da Nang, Vietnam several years ago. I was there as a legal expert for the Secretariat and for the member states who were represented. It was in a hotel room that was about 5 times the size of this room. And yet, there were only 10 delegations, so at maximum 2 people each. And so when I asked the ASEAN Secretariat, I said, are there any other people coming to the meeting? They told me there weren't any. The second thing I asked was, I thought we were reviewing the ASEAN Regional Investment Agreements. Where are the other bodies? They said it wasn't necessary because they would circulate comments from the meeting. When the meeting progressed and the individual member states were asking about the fairness of investment and were bringing out concerns about the operations of multinationals within their jurisdictions, they kept raising concerns of what amounted to responsible investment. And yet there was no resource person at that meeting to talk about what could be done at a regional level as well as at a national level. What I told my counterpart, the ASEAN Secretariat, was simply this. Certainly there was space for one legal expert to come, and in a room that was built for the size of 100 people, there was certainly more than enough space, needed space, for the kind of expertise that EICHR and the other international human rights organizations who could be accredited to ASEAN and who could be present to give their inputs on what happens when responsible investment does not occur in anyone's jurisdiction. Second anecdote. I was in Manila last year, for, as was everybody, I think, when the Philippines had the chair, and I attended 2 particular meetings of the ASEAN Economic Community. I attended, most importantly, the ASEAN Coordinating Council meeting with their dialogue partners, and what is actually going to be the most important document for the region, which is the ASEAN Master Plan on Connectivity 2025. This maps out all the priority cross-border infrastructure, connectivity, maritime connectivity projects in the region. And again, it was held in a hotel in Manila that could have easily seated 200. The dialogue partners were all there. They were all raising their hands for who wanted to do what, who wanted to offer facilities for particular research in procurement or in trade in goods and services, in the digital economy, in Britain, in building the national, rather the regional broadband corridor. And yet, again, everyone was raising concerns about what made trade fair in the region. Everyone was raising concerns about how to bring in more women entrepreneurs, how to bring in more small and medium enterprises. And yet, again, the EICHR nor any of the other sectoral bodies from the ASCC or the APSC were not present in the room. The constant refrain I was given was that this was an AAC project and they needed targeted inputs. And yet the very same queries that were being raised by business, by the way, the chambers of commerce were all there and very easily represented at the Master Plan on Connectivity meeting. Because of course, who was going to bid for these projects if not ASEAN businesses and multinationals as well? If they had seats in that room, it was utterly surprising that nobody from the public interest sector was even represented. Not even ASEAN's own governmental human rights organizations were present. Last anecdote. In my current work around the world, we're in a unique time where everyone is taking it as a fact of international life that treaties are being renegotiated because more and more populations are questioning whether trade is fair. Whether it's the United States renegotiating the Trans-Pacific Partnership or the CPTP now, or RCEP, or in the case of bilateral agreements that have to be renegotiated, or the case of the United Kingdom and the European Union with Brexit, the version in question today from almost everywhere around the world, except maybe in this part of the world, is what makes trade fair, and how do we determine what makes it fair? And to that determination of this question, other regions of the world are genuinely inclusive in the consultations procedure, at least, even in NAFTA, where there are consultations problems, but at least make an effort to formalize a consultations process that brings in all stakeholders to trade and investment. And sad to say, as I will discuss today, these three anecdotes highlight where we are and where we could be later in the future. My outline is supposed to be on three aspects, but because Commissioner Jungin gave such an excellent elaboration of the right to development, I'm going to gloss over part B on sustainability as both means and ends of ASEAN law. I will instead focus on reorienting and reminding us of our understanding of rights within the framework of ASEAN law, because there were so many questions yesterday about enforcement. Do we do this at the national level? Do we do this at the regional level? And how do we particularly do this as human rights scholars, advocates, practitioners, or those who are concerned with what is fair and responsible trade and investment? How do we do this within the levers of the ASEAN bureaucracy or from the member-driven initiatives within ASEAN? Finally, I will build on what Commissioner Jungin recommended, which is cross-pillar action, which is sorely needed right now. Because everywhere else in the world, the issue of what makes fair, responsible, transparent, accountable trade and investment is indeed a cross-sectoral issue that is no longer siloed into just the economic pillar. But unfortunately, and I hope very much, especially from the beginning with the Summer Institute, the future initiatives of ASEAN will consider that, again, if we emphasize the centrality of ASEAN and the people-centered nature of ASEAN, that means a genuine consultations procedure, a genuine accreditation of not just multinationals and chambers of commerce to sit at the table, but also to give and enable input of information from human rights and public interest groups and concerned local communities to know the kind of development that their leaders and the region are setting for everyone. So briefly on understanding rights in the framework of ASEAN law. We have heard Ambassador Aung say it yesterday. It is so much about reforming what goes on at the national level, and that is indeed very true. The core principle in the ASEAN Charter is Article 5, Paragraph 2, which says that member states must take all necessary measures, including the implementation of domestic legislation, in order to effectively implement the provisions of the Charter and all the obligations of membership. So in the first place, when we look to enforcement, the agreements concluded at the ASEAN level will depend on our respective national courts, our national legislatures, our national mechanisms for enforcement, unless it is otherwise stipulated in the agreement themselves. And if there is a corresponding mandate to do it at the regional level. Second, is that ASEAN member states are creating a body of ASEAN law that have binding legal effect. And we are no longer in the era of a series of instruments that could be disregarded or could be set aside on the basis of certain scorecards. But actually, we have to look at the binding effect of these particular obligations that we commit to take on at the regional level. This legislative output is both, at the same time, regional law and also draws heavily from international law. And we see this in the foundations of our ASEAN Charter, which provides for the legal continuity of all 40 years of instruments, treaties, and agreements that were concluded before ASEAN became a governmental organization or a formal governmental organization with legal personality. And these continue to the present regime where we are governed by ASEAN Charter law, and the member states have to act according to Charter law. The very same Charter mandates that our member states should act according to the rule of law, in defense of rule of law, in defense of human rights and fundamental freedoms, and to uphold UN Charter and international law. That's at the very highest fabric of ASEAN law. Third, the degree of internalization of ASEAN law in every ASEAN member state jurisdiction is something that we all have to understand, because not everybody internalizes ASEAN law with the same way. The nature of governance also differs, and we respect this, the nature of what ASEAN has been for the last 40 years. And this determines the modalities of enforcement at the national level. Some jurisdictions and different constitutional regimes embrace international law differently. Cambodia, for example, elevates instruments, core instruments of human rights, at a constitutional level. It doesn't even require legislative implementation. Some jurisdictions, such as Vietnam and the Philippines, Vietnam in particular, gives direct effect to treaties without need of legislative implementation. Philippines, for some treaties, requires further legislative implementation. So this is also something that we have to be mindful of when we're trying to understand how ASEAN law could be enforced. This takes me to the issue of sustainability and why it is the ends and means in ASEAN law, and as Commissioner Jamin so eloquently elaborated, the right to development by itself, by its very incorporation in our founding documents of the ASEAN Charter, as well as in the Treaty of Amity and Cooperation, should be sufficient for us to have the legal anchor to enable organizations to participate in the legislative process that is taking within ASEAN, especially for the economic community. The right to development has already been discussed. Sustainable development, I referenced the definition, but of course the human rights practitioners and environmental rights practitioners would be very familiar with both definitions, so I'm going to move over from there. I'll invite attention to the fact that in our very preamble, our very purposes as a charter-based organization, do provide for sustainable development, very similar to the WTO, which says in its very same preamble that the purpose of development or the purpose of economic activity is to achieve this kind of sustainable development. And if we take a look at the genealogy, as Professor Reed mentioned yesterday, it's true, the ASEAN Regional Trade and Investment Agreements look really good on paper, to the extent that they make the kind of references that treaties in the United States or treaties in the EU or other treaties that are being renegotiated right now are only beginning to explore. The EU has CETA, but that also has different differences of formulation that are not quite the same as how we have done it at the ASEAN level. Almost all of them in the regional investment treaties refer to balanced investment or sustainable development, balanced economic development. However, as Lucy pointed out yesterday, cases are not being brought under the ASEAN Regional Investment Treaties. Why? Because the ASEAN member states themselves have not been legislating the regional investment treaties in tandem with the review of their own investment treaty programs, their bilateral, pre-existing bilateral investment treaty programs. If you're an investor who doesn't want to be bothered with so many host state defenses the way we have built them in the regional investment agreements, you're going to bring claim under the bilateral investment treaties. And true enough, the claims that have been brought against ASEAN member states were all brought against the very old investment treaties that have nowhere been dealt with by the member state organizations when they legislate at the regional level. Second, the trade agreements, whether it's trade in goods, trade in services, or the plethora of trade agreements that we have, all may generally emulate the WTO path of ensuring that there are purposes for a sustainable development and balanced economic growth. Even the design of public policy exceptions are wholesale incorporated from WTO jurisprudence, so exceptions relating to health and phytosanitary measures, among others. So it's not like our agreements don't already have this. They are already present, and it's a question of how we effectively use them and open up our own procedures, but at the same time, recognize what could be done at the regional level as well as at the national state level. And again, we have the standing regional instruments on human rights and sustainability, as was discussed previously, but I'll also point out that we have a rich body of ASEAN environmental instruments and ASEAN labor instruments. In fact, last year in Manila, One of the last achievements of the chairmanship under the Philippines was the conclusion of the Migrant Workers Accord, which is supposed to establish protections for migrant workers within Southeast Asia, contrary to the lack of law. At least the consensus was able to establish a facility for ensuring this kind of regional protection of the rights of migrant workers. But none of these instruments, the irony is, I go back to the three anecdotes I began with, in this talk, none of these instruments ever make it to the kind of expert meetings that are being conducted at the economic community side when we're discussing measures on trade, reform of trade agreements, or discussing measures on the reform of investment agreements. And the reasoning that is often given is that, well, what we do is very technical. We're just going to circulate what we do to the other bodies and then let them comment. But the difficulty with that is also when you're locked into a draft, when you have already painstakingly negotiated every provision of a draft, even if you circulate it later on and there are any comments that come from the ASCC regarding the draft, there's hardly any impetus to change the provisions in a manner that would reflect those kinds of sensibilities. It is too much after the fact because the ASCC bodies are not even present at the outset when the needs are being identified in drawing up the kind of legislation, or rather treatification, that we have in trade and investment. So, to go to cross-pillar cooperation on human rights and ASEAN economic agreements, as I said earlier, the irony is, we're in the era where everywhere else around the world, it is unchallenged logic now, given the kind of economic, global economic crises that have hit populations around the world. It is the unchallenged convention that trade indeed must be fair, that investment must be responsible, that economic activities must be sustainably done. And the question, the difficult question, is always, how do you determine that? Do we leave it to our political leaders to make the assessment? In the case of the United States, the trade representative does a selective consultations procedure, so when they're trying to, even in the NAFTA renegotiations, they've set out a broad set of objectives, but the trade representative invites certain groups. And the groups that most certainly make it to the consultations procedure are the chambers of commerce. And quite rightly, we understand, they're the ones undertaking economic activities. But the irony is, it's a government that's questioning whether trade has been fair, for example, in the Rust Belt manufacturing sector of the United States. And yet, you do not see the presence at the negotiating table, at the consultations procedure, of any other groups that are not necessarily business, who may necessarily have valuable information on how to do things better at engaging communities at that level. Even something as simple as, because right now, Southeast Asia is touted as having the infrastructure boom. We are in a build, or at least the Philippines likes to call it that. But we are in a phase of massive infrastructure development around the region to establish connectivity, to ensure that there's more capital mobility, to enable our workers to move across borders more easily. And yet, the surprising consequences of these large-scale developments are left to the reactions of the public sector long after the developments have already been initiated. If you're a group or a local community that's impacted, say, by a mining operation or a cross-border infrastructure facility that is being built in your region, unless you're invited to the table, you're never going to be able to articulate your concerns meaningfully in the design of that economic development activity. And that is certainly where ASEAN can stand to learn from where the rest of the world is going. Whether it is NAFTA, CPTPP, or even the Paris Climate Change Agreement that will call for an overhaul or a restructuring of the way businesses conduct their operations, especially with a view to renewable resources, whether from Brexit or from the US Trade Representative's actions in reviewing the Korea-US Agreement, or even what's being done at the global level in reviewing whether or not we should have investor-state dispute settlement mechanisms. I mean, just as a sidebar, I often find it interesting that there's so much emphasis on investor-state dispute settlement, and the comments are understandable on all sides, because of course this is an avenue where you have a multinational corporation that can sue a government, which is unheard of for quite a while, and especially given the kind of big compensation awards that they can render, truly something unheard of. It is still a lingering pathology in the system that an investor can win $50 billion in suit, and yet if you're a victim of genocide or if you're a victim of serious and egregious human rights violations, you will never be awarded the kind of compensation that investors are awarded. That's a separate debate, and surely our ASCC organizations are also present, I think, in the UNCITRAL working group. But beyond the dispute settlement mechanism, from where ASEAN does its work best, which is monitoring and information dissemination to the member states, so much can still be done. When the rest of the world is already doing this, in ensuring that there is collaborative cross-sectoral action to ensure a greater level of transparency, and so that there are more people who actually decide what fair trade and responsible investment, sustainable development actually mean. So for me at least, the same thing that I would tell my students is, we can read the technicalities of 21,000 pages of agreements in the WTO, and I do teach international economic law. It can get very detailed and technical. But if you're interested in the public policy questions, there are essentially only three questions you want to ask, whether as an ASEAN citizen or as a member of the regional organization or even as a community member. And it's as simple as this. In an era of renegotiation, in an era of these big megatrend agreements such as RCEP, which sectors will be affected or displaced by the supposed rule changes? And I can't emphasize this enough, because everybody talks about the growth-creating effects of trade and how it's enough if the pie gets bigger, everyone gets happier. Now, that's a whole branch of economics, and we can discuss that at length. But the difficulty is, even if the pie gets bigger, if not everybody gets a reasonable slice of that pie, then growth is for what purpose? Growth entrenches which interests? How is this still a people-centered ASEAN? In the same manner, and of course in trade, because there will always be displacing effects, we make certain choices to make market access more beneficial, say for agriculture versus manufacturing, there will be jobs that are lost in the process. A side note here is, long before the current administration in the United States started attacking NAFTA or all these trade agreements, if they were reading their own governmental reports every year, the National Bureau of Labor in the United States publishes a little-known report that estimates how many jobs will be lost from the implementation of a trade agreement. They actually know, before they signed NAFTA, that a certain amount of jobs in the manufacturing sector were going to be hit. But they thought it was okay because it would be compensated for by new industries. But the difficulty was they didn't provide for a clear facility for trade adjustment. When you're adjusting to the impacts of trade, you need to train people, you need to educate them, and you need to forecast as a business down the line whether or not the skill set that your workers have now will still be effective far into the future. And that's not even factoring automation yet, and the kind of displacement that automation will bring. And yet these are the kind of questions that business asks in trade conferences with governments. Always. And it's always surprising to me, as the backbencher has to listen to this, that nobody asks who's going to be displaced and what's going to be done when they're displaced. Second question, which leads me to the second question of what mechanisms are in place. Commissioner Jamin spoke about the needs-based development as opposed to a rights-based development. So if you think that government has a primordial duty to provide, then you would think that this is always going to be needs-based. based development. If, on the other hand, you think government has a role in empowering its own citizens to ensure that they can cope with the stresses of economic globalization, your policymakers would be more pressed to think about how to adjust, given that these trade agreements will have impacts far into the future. Now, I actually read the TPP, all 6,000 pages of it, which is why when I read all the criticisms, the first thing I asked people is, have you actually read the 6,000 pages? Because barring the investment chapter and the IP chapter, everything else was actually quite good. Good in the sense that there were avenues for adjustment, there was a transition period that enabled countries to adjust to the kind of rule changes that would be expected in the telecommunications sector, for example. Even e-procurement was provided for in the TPP. And yet everybody latched on to investor state, and everybody latched on to the IP chapters, quite rightly. But in our RCEP discussions, and whatever has been supposedly leaked online as the draft text, and I have an article that's coming out on this one, so I hope it doesn't become too irrelevant by the time RCEP is passed at the end of the year. The odd thing was, while there are all of these major adjustments to the digital economy, to procurement, to competition, to new standards, especially for the enforcement of regulatory prerogatives by states. Not only was there no human rights impact assessment, nobody talks human rights at the drafting of these matters, but there was no sustainability study for the kind of shifts and transitions that would be expected from these kinds of new transitions and new digital economies. And it was surprising, because this is a 16-member mega regional trade agreement that was expected to have the kind of displacing effects, and yet it was left up to the member states to figure out how to adjust. And surely, many things can be done at the national level, but if you don't have the information at the outset when you're drafting, and you have to pass this off to a bureaucrat back in your home country for them to figure it out, true enough, you will not accomplish meaningful changes to the way business is done or the way treaties are drafted. And lastly, which is relevant for all of us who are voters somewhere, who's making decisions to favor interests and why? And I can't emphasize this enough, why consultations and meaningful consultations procedure is necessary, why meaningful transparency, not just broad-based notions of transparency, are necessary to inform decision-making processes at the economic pillar. I was heartened to note from our official from the ASEC that there was so much coordinating being done behind the scenes, and indeed our ASEAN bureaucrats work tirelessly in the kind of work that we have to do at all fronts. But latching on to that message, there is not much communication of the information that is received at the coordinating level. When that information is not present, decision makers cannot effectively decide on who gains and who loses from trade and investment. So to conclude, since I have 3 minutes, if we're human rights enforcers in ASEAN, and so many persons who are here present will no doubt attest, the task is gargantuan. Because you have to not only navigate the regional level, you also have to navigate how does this all work. We have a lot of really good instruments, so many bodies. How do you function within the ASEAN bureaucracy, and especially when the ASEAN Secretariat has a minuscule budget compared to the budget of the European Union? So we don't have that kind of entrenched civil bureaucracy that the European Union has. At the ASEAN member state level, depending on what your national law is, you could be litigating individual cases at the national courts, asking for judicial review of these economic agreements. The Philippines likes to do this, and it's all pending before the Philippine Supreme Court. You could lobby regulatory decision-making at your level, whether it's competition law, or consumer protection, or procurement, and try to influence the kind of rules that are being made administratively or the kind of decisions that are being made by regulators. For example, the activities of Uber and whether or not they're giving any labor guarantees to the so-called independent contractors that they're engaging in their business model. Third, you could do long-term advocacy, which was discussed yesterday, through proper education, not just of business, but also business schools, financial institutions, and other stakeholders, so that there would be more familiarity with incorporating and internalizing business practices, this ethos that our kind colleague pointed out yesterday, that human rights is not a cost, but rather, it is the investment in how to do business right. Or you could try to influence legislation at the national level and how a member state will set agendas at every ASEAN meeting. That's what you can do at the national level. At the regional level, which is where I think we have room for reform, there's still limited windows for broad public participation and monitoring of the regional processes of trade and investment lawmaking. Every time there's a sectoral review of the performance scorecards and implementation of the ASEAN blueprints, I love how there's always a section on we've become inclusive without really being inclusive. There's a report that comes from a certain ASCC body, but it's never really integrated with what SEOM does. And it's really no fault of their own, because they have to proceed from the mandate of what the member states do. But perhaps this is an impetus to try and dialogue further. You can also try to engage dialogue with the ASEAN human rights bodies and try to encourage them to attend these vast hotel rooms with virtually no people except economic technocrats and try to weigh in on what fair and responsible investment means. Or, as Lucy elaborately discussed yesterday, you could try to start availing of incipient ASEAN dispute resolution mechanisms that are in the treaties themselves and try to litigate from there. You can do it through arbitration, through the dispute settlement mechanism. In the Vientiane Protocol and Enhanced Dispute Settlement Mechanism, it's unclear what the scope is because there's a provision in Article 1 that refers to economic agreements. So virtually every single economic agreement that's issued under ASEAN could technically fall under the Vientiane Protocol, but we haven't set up the bodies that are supposed to hear these kinds of disputes. And there's the last piece of work that I've been engaged in this year, which is on writing up the new rules on business and human rights arbitration, which hopefully will be useful in allowing human rights victims to sue in the way that in the Bangladesh Accord, the victims and the workers in the Rana Plaza tragedy were able to arbitrate against the companies to achieve fair settlement and changes in company policies. These are still works in progress. And Lucy stood up, so I'm going to conclude with this. Do we need more explicit human rights related provisions? I'd say not necessarily. The moment we incorporate the right to development, it already, for me, is the legal hook that brings in the body of ASEAN law and human rights. And if we don't do it at the level of the contract, which is what Urbaser versus Argentina illustrates, it's not necessarily going to be applicable law in a dispute. Second, but do we need more responsive frameworks for cross-border human rights enforcement? And my answer to that is absolutely yes. We have to be imaginative, we have to be familiar with how ASEAN law works, but most importantly, we have to be strategic in how to ensure that the trade and investment decisions we're making ultimately redound to the very same ends of human rights that we all aspire to have in ASEAN. On that note, thank you.